Hello, my beloveds. How are you?
This is another Impulse production.
You are listening to Red Sable, and this is Feed Your Mind, Fuel Your Soul. How are you today? I hope you are well. I hope that you are in a good state of mind. I hope that whatever was troubling you yesterday or earlier today, that you're in a better position to let all of that go and enjoy the rest of your day. The holiday weekend is almost over, so try to make the best of whatever it is that is left of it and take care of you and do something special for yourself today. Okay? Thank you so much for joining me. It has been a little bit of time. I have been under the weather. I caught a cold from my beautiful G-baby, but it's okay. He is perfect. So I'll be happy to catch a cold from him anytime. Except when I'm coughing and then I'm like, no, I don't want it anymore. Leave it alone. Just leave me alone. But it's okay. So it's hard to record when, you know, your throat is scratchy and burning and all that other kind of stuff. But anyway, I digress. Let's move on. I hope you're well. I hope that you are in a good state of health. There's a lot going on, and not just with COVID. Colds are coming from out of nowhere. People are getting sick just from the average cold that tends to linger. We have extra things that are going on with all of us who have allergies, right? So I hope that you're just in a better place, okay? Just a couple of updates, all right? You can continue to reach me, of course, on my email address, at my email address, which is talktoredsable@gmail.com. That's T-A-L-K. The number 2, redsable at gmail.com. What did I just say? redsable at gmail.com. Ciao. I probably need some more sleep because that's another thing. You don't get to sleep when you're sick and it's hard to breathe. Anyway, I digress. Let's move on. You can continue to reach me there. You can also text or send a voicemail. Leave a voicemail at 917-563-0611. It's 917-563-0611. And as I have been mentioning before, I'm still looking for producers who have some amazing love and gifts and talent for producing music, right? In the style of jazz or R&B or gospel productions or a little bit of pop. You know, I'm not really a rock station, but I'm good with just a little bit of pop and pop soul, and you know, that's good. Hip hop, of course, that's good too. Just keep it in that particular vein. Instrumentals are better because it flows with the background. That's what it is for. It's for background sound, okay? And I will definitely give you your credit. Of course, I do not want to take credit for your work. It does not belong to me. The music that you're hearing in the background is called Altitude, and it's by Infasol Productions. I love his work because he uses live instrumentations, and that is always good with me. So, the next piece of information that I want to let you know about is you can also reach me on Stereo. Stereo is a show that I do every other week with one of my podcasting neighbors. He is amazing, talented, funny, Cyber Shots. We do a show every other Saturday. So you'll be hearing a couple of new episodes coming up over the next couple of days from the recordings that we did on, I should say, the live streams that we did. Okay. And also you can reach me now on Clubhouse. All right. I'm very new to Clubhouse, but you can reach me at missred.sable at Clubhouse. Let's connect. Let's talk about many different things because it's a wide open genre of all kinds of topics of information over there, right? I don't know if you've ever been on Clubhouse, but it's an experience. But I'm still trying to figure things out. So let's figure that out together. If you're not on there yet, let's figure it out together. Let's create a club, talk about things and music and talk about things and mental health and talk about all kinds of topics of information that we want to bring out regarding our communities and relationships. And let's just talk about those kinds of things and let's connect. Okay. Let's do what we do as creators and share our visionary views with others. Visionary Views is also a show that I do on Stereo that I want to continue to do every Friday. I'm sorry, every other Friday or every other Saturday. So it'll be the alternate because I do the Saturdays with Cyber Shots. So, yeah. So let me know if that works for you. All right. And yeah, that's it with the update. So thank you, thank you, thank you. We are still in Mental Health Awareness Month. All right. However, I am going to be always sharing information regarding mental health awareness, domestic violence, those have been hurt and have disabilities because of domestic violence, all kinds of things when it comes to sexual assault. I will share those stories and I will be doing them in story forms or have an interview or two with someone who is also an advocate or an expert in that field. Okay, so join me, won't you? Today, we are going to be listening to part two of Kaleidoscope. So hopefully you listen to part one. We're not joined together. Okay, so you can listen to one and not listen to the other. So it's okay. But it's part two because it involves the same person that I told you I love very much. And it is a family member. So this is part two of her particular story. All right. So it's Ebony Kaleidoscope part two. So thank you. I appreciate you. I appreciate you. And I really, really hope that you are good. All right. I hope you're good. And I'm saying that because I'm feeling some energy. It's just feeling all kinds of energy lately that's telling me that people are not in good spaces. They say that they are, but they really are not. So I hope that you're good. There's been some issues with not just me being sick, but there's been some family issues too. And we're just struggling a little bit, but that's okay. It's okay to struggle a little bit. It's okay to say that you're not okay. It's okay to share that. And you don't have to share that with me. You can share that with family or friends, or if you are seeing a local therapist, or you're doing something online or social media. They have live chats with therapists now. So however you're going to get what heals you, then get what heals you the best way that you can, because we all need support, right? So like I said, coming up next, it will be Ebony Kaleidoscope, all right? So enjoy that. Again, if you have any questions, and it's a little much to hear, so I'm saying enjoy loosely because it's really not an enjoyable conversation. However, I hope that it helps you. I hope that it gives you a little bit of insight, okay? And as you lead through your day, just know that we all fall. We all fall down, but we get back up because saints are sinners and we all fall. And that's okay. It doesn't mean that you're no longer a saint. It doesn't mean that you're perfect. It just means that we're flawed human beings. And it's okay to have those flaws because God is going to always see you as perfect in his eyes. He just needs you to accept and receive it. He's always going to see you as flawlessly flawed. You just need to accept that and embrace that. All right?
This is another Infosol production.
I appreciate you, beloved. Enjoy the rest of your day. And those of you who are able to stay, if you have a comment or a question, don't forget, email me or text message me, okay? Thank you so much again. The music that you are listening to in the background is Infosol Productions. It is live instrumentations. He has years of work. Oh my gosh. You need to go to his website because the work is just, it's crazy. And every song has its own different type of nuance and appeal to it, because it's always going to give you something that's a little bit different. Like, you can still tell it's him, but it's still going to give you a little bit something different. So I don't know. I'm a lover of music, and I feel like music is a part of my healing process. It healed me. Prayer, God, it healed me. And he gave me music as a gift, and he gave me the ability to be able to gather people around me that are in the same field and help them to reach their fullest potential in the music business, in the film business, in the fashion business. So I'm a servant of love and purpose and being passionate about what it is that you were called to do. Okay? You can't always be dominant and everything that goes on. Sometimes we have to be willing to sit back, be slow to speak, slow to listen. Okay? Quick to listen, I should say.
This is
slow to speak. Because sometimes we just talk, and we don't hear each other. So be slow to speak. All right? Quick to listen. Okay? And a shoulder to lean on. Because someone needs you today. All right? Hug someone today. Be joyful today. Even if it's not really feeling so joyful for you, you could bring joy to all those around you by being just a radiance of help. Show them that there is hope beyond the helplessness that we feel sometimes, okay? So thank you. I appreciate you. You deserve all the love and support and applause that you can get. Okay, so we are moving on. Thank you so much. And so, Ebony Kaleidoscope Part 2. Here we go, my contribution to mental health. This is entitled Ebony Kaleidoscope Part 2. The house was buzzing, filled with people, food and laughter, joyful noises all around, kids running around and playing, singing songs. There is birthday celebration going on for a toddler. There is food being cooked on a stove, all types of soul food aromas running through the air, pies and cakes and chicken and macaroni and cheese and cornbread and you name it, it was there. Elders were placed at their tables, playing dominoes, talking, chatting on one floor. On the next floor, there were more adults gathered in the kitchen, making whatever last-minute arrangements regarding the food, making sure that was done. There was some gathered in another room, watching these children play and talking and catching up. It's been a while. Some relatives haven't been seen in a while, so good vibes are going on with everyone. A family enters the room. There seems to be a little agitation in the air, but no one thinks nothing of it. A lot going on. All the music is going on in the background, and people are laughing and all happy to see one another. The family walks into the room and hollers of happy hellos and hugs all around. There's one young woman standing there with a look on her face. Not really sure if that was a look of disdain, anger, or just not wanting to be there. So is it a look of disinterest? Not really sure. Interaction with others was a little standoffish. Going through the motions, of course. Hugging, saying hello, smiling. Every now and again, giving dirty looks to one of the passengers in the car, who's now sitting at the table. But moving forward through the house and acting like everything was fine. The rest of the family that came was huddled in a corner trying to figure out what's going on. Why was she acting funny in the car? She said she wanted to be here. A little confused because she acts like she doesn't want to be here at all. And why does she keep looking like that? What is that face about? What's the problem? So the gentleman walks over to her and he asks her, "Are you all right?" She claims that she's fine. She says that she is. She's fine. She wants to go and smoke a cigarette. So he said, "Okay, but if you want, I could drive you back home. It's not a problem. But you're not going to bring that attitude here. Not here and not today." She says, "Oh, no, there's no attitude. I'm fine. I'm fine." So she goes downstairs and she's smoking a cigarette and talking to some other family members. They don't notice anything. They don't think that there's an issue at all. They're just oblivious to the interactions, not realizing anything about the argument that happened before the family got into the car, the confrontation that happened before the family got into the car, the slamming of a plate of food that slammed on the concrete. For whatever reason, the argument that happened between the young woman and her husband before the family got into the car and drove off to the family dinner and birthday celebration. They had no idea. So dinner is being served, and everyone is sitting around their places, eating, laughing, telling jokes. The young woman decides she doesn't want to eat. She's not hungry. So she wants to go back outside. That was not a good idea, is what one of the cousins said. "No, it's dark out there. You know, we live over here in the suburbs. This is a wooded area. You can't go out there by yourself. So let us all finish eating and we could just all go out there together." She was insistent on going. He kept on saying, "Why? What's the matter with you? What's the problem? If you want to smoke a cigarette, you just go right downstairs. We have a balcony. You could just go on down and stand there and smoke your cigarette. It's not a problem." "No, I want to go outside. I want to go outside," she kept insisting. So one of the elders went over to her, calmed her down, and told her, "You can wait until dinner is finished, and you can calm down. And when we're done, then the group of you can go out," just like he suggested, "because it is really dark out there. There is no light out there." So she says, fine. I'll sit down. I'll wait. So everything seems to be okay until she comes storming back into the house, crying tears, and runs into one of the bedrooms. One of the elders gets up, an elderly woman, an older woman. She gets up and she goes into the room. She says, "What's going on with her?" And the family says, "We don't know. She's acting like that. She got into an argument with her husband. She's just been acting like that. We don't have any idea what's going on." He said that she hadn't been sleeping or eating or doing any of her normal activities, and he doesn't know what else to do. So he thought if she was around family, that she would be better. Obviously, it's not working. And she said she'll go and talk to her. So she goes and talks to her. They seem to have a good conversation. And the conversation goes on for a good 20 minutes. So she says, okay. Well, she seems to be okay. And she goes out of the room and she says, well, she seems to be okay. I'm just going to go and get her a plate of food because she didn't really eat anything. So let me go and get her some food. So she goes and she gets her some food. Now, one of the passengers was the parent of this young woman. So she goes in and she says, okay, well, she's going to get you food. What's going on? Are you all right? Instant tears dried up. Anger ensued, directed directly at the mother. What you want to know for? What you asking me questions for? Taken aback, the mother said, what do you mean? Because you was in here for 20 minutes and I see you crying. I just want to find out if you're okay. So is everything all right? We can talk if you want. I don't want to talk to you. Okay. Why not? What's the problem? So the mother's proceeding to try to figure out what's going on with her. She can't. The girl seems very, very distant. One of the aunts come in the room and she says, is everything all right? And the young woman smile automatically comes back on her face. Oh, yeah, I'm fine. I'm fine. So she says, okay, well, what are y'all doing in here? Well, they're bringing me some food and we're not doing nothing. Okay, well, let me sit down, let me talk and find out what's going on. So she starts to talking to the young woman. Young woman starts to cry again. Now the mother's crying. They're all crying because the energy that is now very confusing has been negative and aggressive for quite some time. But the mother has not been telling that to any of the elders or any of the aunts or the uncles, because she thought that she can handle it on her own and that the daughter was really just going through a hard time and that she just really needed some support. And so that's what she had been doing, supporting her the best way that she could. Her child, the child that she loved and raised. So unbeknownst to her, the daughter had been doing things that she had not been transparent about. And one of the things that she had been doing was smoking illegal substances that were laced with things that started making her very, very ill in the ways of altering her personality, altering her mental state of being, making her very paranoid. And the mother did not know this until some time later. So the aunt sits down, she has a conversation, she's talking, and everyone is crying, and then she gets up and she goes to see what's going on with this food. So she says, I'm gonna be right back. So the aunt goes out of the room, leaves the daughter and a mother in. The mother's wiping her tears and she goes to try to sit next to her daughter to ask her what's going on. The daughter immediately turns on her and jumps up and says, Don't sit next to me. What do you think you're doing? You think I don't know? So the mother stands up because the daughter's standing up. What do you mean? You don't know what? What is it that I don't think you know? What are you talking about? I know about you and him. You know about me and him what? Who, him, who? I know that you've been sleeping with my husband. And I know that you're having his baby. So she looked at her and she said, well, you talk. She said, you know what? I think that you need to calm down. I think that you really need to look at me. I'm your mother. What are you saying? What are you talking about? I know. And the daughter takes three steps towards her mother. The mother takes three steps back because now there's a very angry, aggressive, loud talking young woman coming at her. So she's wondering, okay, now it's time for me to protect myself in what was a small space filled with furniture, nowhere to get out but one way, and the daughter standing at the door was the only way out. So she immediately thought, I'm going to have to fight my child because she doesn't know who I am. So she's looking at her and she's saying, I'm your mother. You are not my mother. I don't know who you are, but I know that you've been lying and you've been cheating and sleeping with my husband. And before I get real ugly, you're going to have to tell me the truth. You're going to have to let me know what you did. So the mother tries to explain to her that she's not seeing what she thinks she's seeing, that she is not the enemy, that she is her mother. And she said, oh, my mother would never do anything. You are a thought. You're a bird. You need to get out my face. You need to get out my face right now. So the mother is shocked by what is being told to her. So she said, what are you talking? You called me a bird. I'm a thought. What? So now the mother is checking her own anger because she's wondering, now is it time for me to start whipping behinds in here? Or do I just fall back and let her continue? And then how much am I supposed to stand here and allow this to go on before she decides that she's going to leap? So the daughter comes a couple of steps closer, and now the mother doesn't have anywhere to go. She's backing up into some bikes that's sitting behind her. So she says, look, I'm not going to fight you in this house because this is not our home. We are in someone else's house, and you are acting out. I don't know what it is that you think that you know or what it is that you're remembering or who you think that I am, but I am your mother. And if you keep on with this, we are going to have to fight. And she says, well, then come on. And then when she says that, the door opens and relatives start coming in because now they're hearing the yelling above the music that was playing softly in the background while everybody was sitting at the kitchen having their dessert and laughing and talking. No one had any idea what was going on until the voices became loud. So they come in the room. The daughter turns around, realizes that she has an audience, still unaware of where she is. Just know that she has an audience behind her. She takes that as permission and fuel to again insult her mother, calling her out her name, telling her that she was nothing but a lay, that he don't really want you, that you need to not even think about having a family with him, because if you do, it's going to be very bad for you. So the relatives, the elders, are telling her to shut up. Who are you talking to like that? You don't disrespect your mother like that. Oh, F her. Who she thinks she is? That ain't my mother. She's a thought. And I don't know why you're taking up for. What is she even doing here? And they're looking at her and they're looking at the mother. The mother is uncontrollably angry because she can't do anything. So she starts to shake and she starts to try to hold back tears that are welling up in her eyes as she looks at this woman that she gave birth to, this woman that she gave up everything for, and she doesn't even know her. She doesn't recognize her. So the young woman is escorted out of the room by one of the cousins. He says to her, look, cuz, you got to get out of here. You can't. What are you doing? My kids is up in here. What's wrong with you? And she started saying some stuff to him, and he looked at her, and he went into the room, and he spoke to the young woman's uncle, and he said, yo, I don't know what's up with her. He said, but something is wrong. You need to go, and you need to talk to your niece. Something is wrong. I don't see her. I don't see her behind those eyes. I don't see her. I don't see the young girl that I used to know. I don't see her there. I see someone who is devoid of any emotions. There's no connection. She's talking to me, but there's no connection there. He said, it's like talking to some type of demon. He said, something is going on. She needs to go to a hospital. So the uncle jumps up. What are you talking about? What do you need? What do you need me to do? I could take her wherever we need to take her. But she was acting funny when she got here. But she didn't smoke anything. There was nothing going on in my car. You know, I don't allow that. So he was like, yo, I'm telling you, this is the situation. Either you're going to have to take her to the hospital, or she's going to hurt somebody. And I don't know if she's directing that at your sister. So you need to go and do something. So he's like, okay. So he goes in there. The daughter is now standing outside and trying to be calmed down by a couple of the elders. Aunts are there trying to calm her down, trying to figure out what's going on, what's the matter with you, why are you acting like this? And she's insisting she wants to leave. So they said, okay, we're getting ready to go. So it was time to leave. We get in the car, and it was told that we should not leave her alone. So we didn't want to leave her alone. And we were told that we can't break her into the car either. Right? So we didn't. She was left with the family. And we drove where we would be able to get the mother out to safety, so that she would be okay and she will no longer have to interact with the daughter. And as that was happening, the phone starts ringing on the uncle's cell phone, and he picks it up, and it's being yelled at by the husband, who was saying, how you going to leave my wife in the middle of the road in the pitch black dark? He said, what are you talking about? We left her at a house full of people. And who are you yelling at? He was like, look, I'm sorry, I apologize, but she's screaming, she's all upset, and she's talking about she's out there in the dark, she's by herself, and y'all left her. He said, we didn't leave her anywhere. So he says, look, you stay by the phone. I'm going to call and find out what's going on. He calls the house and finds out that she decides that she's going to walk out of the house into the dark, to who knows where. She had no clue where she was, so she did not know where she was going. So, I'm going to end the story by saying, eventually we did find her, and we did bring her home. But the story continues from there, and it gets even worse from that, if you can imagine, only because that's when we started realizing that there was apparent drug use, and it was starting to alter her mind in ways that we didn't even understand. Thank you so much for listening. I appreciate you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Again, like I said, this is my contribution to Mental Health Month. And these are stories that are based on people in my family, people that I love very much, who are struggling, who are not getting help because of the stigma that there's placed on being told that you have bipolar, that you are psychotic, that you have psychosis, that you have split personalities, that you are abusing drugs to the point where they feel like they, in order for them to help you, you have to go into detox centers. And when you say that to somebody who feels like they are already being imprisoned, and just being in the house seems like a prison to them, imagine trying to get that person to stay in a hospital. They're not going to stay there because they feel like they're being put in yet another jail. So thank you so very, very much. For anyone who's struggling with someone that they love, who is going through some type of mental illness, who is going through this journey of darkness, trying to find the light, who's trying to help themselves to get better by ignoring the problem, by making it worse because they're now trying to cover it up with excessive drug use, pray for them. Because you can't, there's nothing that you can do to physically help them. If they refuse to get help from outside sources, then there's not anything that you can do except for pray for them. If you want to take their calls, you can do that. Don't become a codependent in their journey, because they will always look for you to lean on you to help them, because they're going to always have a problem. And that problem is always going to make no sense to you, but to them, the problem is going to mean everything. If they are homeless, this person is, but they refuse to get into a shelter. They're refusing all types of services, and they're to the point where they're saying that they don't care about what happens to them. That person is crying out for help, but they are afraid to get it. You can't force them. So all I can do is pray for my loved ones and hope that someone is able to get through to them, because continuing to be part of the journey is not going to help them. It's not. Unfortunately, it just doesn't help them. At least that's been my experience. So I appreciate you all again for listening. Thank you, thank you, thank you. I did not intend for this segment to be this long, but if you were able to stay for the extra, 25 minutes? Thank you so much for doing that. Okay, I hope that this helps someone. I know it's a very heavy topic, but it's a very real topic, and these things are happening in our lives every day. Just be mindful that people, that when they're saying things that you don't understand, there's a disconnect there. When they're saying that they don't know who they are, that they don't know where they're going, that they're in dark places, they don't care if they live or die, that they don't care if they get hurt, that they just don't care about nothing at all. Just, if they don't want to get help, don't eat those words to the point where you feel like it's your fault. Okay? Don't allow their dark confusion and negativity to now become you and your life, to impede on who it is and what it is that you're trying to do for you. Okay? Because it will. It will eat you alive if you let it. It will turn you into things that you don't even know or recognize. You will do things that you don't even want to do, that you normally would never do, because you're trying to help this person who keeps telling you that they don't want your help. All they want you to do is give them money, and every now and again, maybe let them sleep on your sofa. But you can't do those things, because to do those things is to give them permission to keep living the way they're living. That's the way they see that message, that you're saying it's okay because you're helping them. So thank you. I appreciate you all. Love, 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 and blessings. Keep rising and soaring. Whatever you do, make sure you continue to do it with love, because love, love, love is the thing. Love, love, love is the thing. Even when we have to love from a distance, it is the thing. Okay? So I will talk to you all very, very soon. I will send out a gospel list right after this, and it will continue to calm and give us some peace in our struggles. with some music of gospel music, or if there's anything else that you do to woosah your way through the trials and the tribulations and the aggravations and the sense of helplessness when it comes to this topic, then I greatly understand. I greatly understand. And if you want to call in and add to the conversation, I'd appreciate that too. Thank you. If you are here on Anchor, definitely you can call in. If not, then you can email me outside of Anchor at talktoredsable@gmail.com. That's T-A-L-A-K, the number 2, R-E-D-S-A-B-L-E @gmail.com. I'll talk to you all very, very soon. Have a blissfully blessed and beautiful, beautiful day. Take care of you. Take care of you. Thank you. Okay, my beloved, so I'm going to leave you with a little bit of this song called Come and Knock on My Door. I'm sorry, Come and Knock on Our Door by Jermaine Dolley. And I fell in love with it because it has the Three's Company theme. Okay, so enjoy that. And again, I'll talk to you very, very soon. Take care.
People who think that their life off track, got a feeling you to come on back. So come on, knock on our door. it away. Thought then my head be feeling clearer. I traveled 70 states. Thought moving around make me feel better. I tried to let go my lover. Thought if I was alone, then maybe I could recover. To write it away, I'll cry it away.
Don't you cry it, babe.
Away.
Okay, my beloveds, I am no longer on the Anchor platform. Well, at least not at this moment. And we're moving on to the next song. I just wanted to give you a little full disclosure to let you know I am no longer on Anchor, all right? You can catch me on all the other platforms, all right? Let's move on. We're going to bless the air a little bit. Just bless the energy a little bit, okay? Thank you.
Listen. The Bible says in Proverbs 24:18, a just man, falleth seven times, but rises back up again. Now, what makes him just? We in the church would call him wicked. If he falls seven times, one time we can understand, twice maybe, but seven times. Well, what makes him just from the Bible standpoint is that he has enough sense to realize that he can get back up. And not only just get back up, but get back in line. No matter where you've fallen from, no matter what you've done, no matter how many times you've done it, it's not too late. He is so much in love with you that his mercy endures. His mercy is everlasting. It's not too late. No matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, God is still faithful and he's still just, even when we're unfaithful and when we're not just. He's so faithful and just, he'll forgive you of every single solitary sin. No matter how many promises you've made and broken, no matter how many times you've done it over and over again, I'm a living witness. He will forgive you like he forgave me. He's just waiting on you to confess. Just say, Lord, have mercy on me. Forgive me. I'm not going to make you any more promises. You know my heart. I want to do right. Show me how. Take me back. Put me back in line. I love you. Teach me how to walk right. Break every habit. Loose me from every addiction. Come into my life and my heart and live in me and through me. I give you my life for the rest of my life. And just that quickly, you're forgiven. Just that quickly, you're healed. He's your God and you're his child. No condemnation. No condemnation. Don't remember the past sins because he's forgotten. Isaiah 43:25 says, I am he that blots out your transgressions. And for mine own sake, I will not remember your sins. If he's forgotten them, then you forgive and forget too. You're healed. You're saved. You're whole. In Jesus' name. Come on, Pastor Wyatt.
I fell down, but I got up. I fell down, but I got up. I fell down, but I got up. 'Cause I found out that a saint is just a sinner who fell down. But it didn't stay there. Everyone lift those hands. The word is so clear. It simply states that if we would confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and would believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, said, thou shalt be saved.
Okay, let's say amen and move on. Next song. Michelle Williams. If we had your eyes.
So I dug through my ashtray. My good deed today changed my life. I thought I knew it all. Quick to write them off. Looked like he was lost. Till I heard him speak. Now I've heard the voice before. I knew that it was your legend on me more than I even believe.
would understand what I'm going through while I'm going through. I'd be more patient. God, help me to see things the way you see things. Did I already say help me to be patient? Say that again. Wow. Give us your eyes, God.
Okay, my beloveds, that was Michelle Williams and Fantasia. It's beautiful. Okay, we're going to end the gospel songs with our girl, Lauryn Hill. And this is Tell 'Em. I love this song.
Tell 'Em. Let me be patient, let me be kind, make me unselfish without being blind. Though I may suffer, I'll envy it not and endure what comes, 'cause he's all that I got. And tell him, tell him I need.
Be alright.
Okay, my beloveds, that was our girl Lauryn Hill, and that was her version of 1 Corinthians 13. It's perfect love, and how you can tell God anything, and it's going to be all right, because it is. I hope that you are able to hold on to that tightly. There are days when I struggle. Because it's hard. It's hard. I'm not saying that it's easy, but it's also not impossible. So with God, all things are possible, right? We have finite minds, but He is infinite. And anything and everything is possible with Him. May not be with humans, but it is possible for God. So I hope that this segment helped you and that you're able to walk away with knowing that you're not alone. When you get a moment, you can check out Silence the Shame, which is run by Shanti Doss. And I believe I spoke to you all about her before. She's an amazing, gifted woman. And she was in the entertainment industry for a while for music. And she had some struggles, and she developed this beautiful organization that now helps people that are struggling with emotional disabilities and afflictions, and we all have them. So she created an organization that helps. And she's currently running an online auction. So if you are interested in that, it's for a book, I believe. I don't want to mislead you. So when you get a chance, just check out Twitter and look for Silence the Shame, and they are running an auction so that they can continue to raise funds for mental health awareness. Okay? Thank you so much. Take care of you. Take care of yours. Don't forget, let's connect. All right? And have a blissfully blessed and beautiful, beautiful, beautiful day. The sun is going to shine because rain doesn't last forever. Storms don't last all day. Rephrase, doesn't last always. The sun is going to shine, and the sun is shining today. So today is a good day, right? So I hope that you have a good day. I'll talk to you soon. Take care of you. Welcome back, beloved. I am Red Sable, and you've been listening to Fuel Your Soul. Thank you for your time and energy.
Make or not leave me, baby, I plead. Sever this love that is making me hazy.